Going on, everyone. Welcome, Rabbit here, and today we get to play with a new toy, and I'm probably going to run into a crap ton of issues, but hey, we won't know until we jump in. So what we got going on here is there's bits and pieces of a little bit of everything here. We'll run through everything fast. Let's just get this out of the box first without breaking anything. It's kind of, there we go. There we go. So we're going to pull that out. Pull this out. Now, this was all wrapped up in a package for video purposes. You know, I did pick this up from Snark. So if you saw this was just sitting here out of the package, you know why. This is preset put here so that I could actually open it and don't have to deal with the packaging. So here we have the C1100 FPGA. Now, if you are not familiar with the term FPGA, that does stand for Field Programmable Gate Array, which is actually a type of integrated circuit. If you've heard of integrated circuit before, that is your ASIC, except unlike an ASIC, this can be programmed and reprogrammed, which means it is fairly profitable, fairly efficient, and pretty damn expensive. Another thing to take note is these things do run pretty darn hot and they have no built-in fans or anything, so you do need sufficient cooling. They're designed more for server cases, server applications, Bitmain, ASIC testing. I'm just kidding about that, or am I really? I don't know. But you do have to have some cooling here. So I do have a little setup actually in the form of that bag. We're gonna pull all this apart and kind of show you and tell you exactly what each piece is for. Okay, so let's kind of go through everything else that Snark did send with this. And if I missed it earlier, you know, I picked this up from Snark. This is his C1100. He let me borrow it and test it out. We can do hash rates, all sorts of fun stuff. Bunch of videos out of this thing because I haven't really dealt with an FPGA before. So this is new to me and it's gonna be a lot of fun. So here's the other pieces he sent. This is actually a 3D printed shroud, I guess, that will hold that fan in there. We'll look at it when I start putting this thing together. You can buy these somewhere. I can't remember where you get these, but once I find out, and if I find out, I will actually put that in the description sometime later on when I actually get the details on that. Or you may already find a way to print these out and do measurements and stuff on your own. But if you do know, let me know down in the comments where you actually buy these. There is a company that makes things especially for these FPGAs. Next up, we have this piece here. Now, I don't know what it's called, but you can see by the pins and stuff, you can see what it's supposed to do. So what happens here is once you put the shroud on, you're actually going to be covering the 8-pin there, so you won't be able to get your 8-pin plug from your power supply in. So this actually will wrap it around the edge so that you can power it here. Obviously, we have our fan here with the fan plug with a controller for that fan. So we're going to be running the fan off this controller, and then we can set it and dial it up, dial it down as needed based on the temperature of this. And then we have this cable here. This is a micro USB to USB. These do not communicate like a normal GPU or anything. They actually have a micro USB cable, so they talk through a USB instead of the PCI Express down there that you see. I don't even know if those do anything. It has the pins and stuff. Maybe it draws a little bit of power. I'm not 100% sure. If you know, Crypto Mikel, you're a pro on this. Serpent X, you're a pro on these FPGA stuff. Let me know if that actually does anything, if it gets any power. I do see pins there, but it might just be for pretty much holding your card down or your FPGA. Again, I don't really know what that does because we do have to power from 8 pins and things, but this is actually how it communicates to everything. It is through USB. All right, so I'm gonna kind of piece this thing together. We can see there's a slot up top, slot on the bottom here, and then also we have kind of, you know, your PCB slots here and here. So those kind of line up in like so. So we're gonna kind of push this in like this. I'm kind of looking around the camera so it looks like I'm doing this horribly. So there we go, we can see it slid right in there. And then when I was talking about earlier, we're not gonna be able to get any type of power cable in there at that point. That's where this will come in, and it'll kind of wrap it around like so. More on that when we obviously get to it. Next up, we're gonna have to install all our screws and everything once we get our fan in. So here's our fan. We can see it's gonna place right in here like so, and then it should blow air. This is obviously a blower style fan. You can see the fan right there. It's gonna spin right here, blow the air through there, and it should push it all through this FPGA, keeping all the internal components nice and cool. So I just installed that little elbow there for the 8 pins. Now you can see we should be able to get a power cable plugged right into there. So here you can see you'll now be powering it from here, and it's just elbowing it in there, kind of like a connector into the power for this FPGA. Okay, so our fan is successfully installed. All it was a bolt going through with a nut on the end, screwed on tight, and you're good to go. It's not rocket science here. Now, next up, we are gonna have to figure out how we're going to power this. We do see the fan controller up there. This fan controller does run off of Molex, as you can see here. Now, if we look here, this is 1.85 amps. I'm not 100% sure what a motherboard fan port can support. I think it's only 1 amp, but I could be wrong. But keep in mind, when you overload motherboards, you may have seen 24 pins and stuff melt in the past. That's usually a result of throwing too many system fans and stuff onto a motherboard. So here we can see 1.85 amps, which is over that 1 amp if a motherboard does only support 1 amp per fan port. So obviously we're gonna be using this fan port. It's a much safer route, as well as using Molex to power all this. So we don't have to worry about the specs here. And this thing, I think, because it is a blower style, will probably be pretty loud. There are other options other than this, but this is what I got and this is what we're gonna use. So before we do get started on anything, I updated HiveOS to all the latest kernels and all the latest versions. And I have a system here with nothing else plugged in of 19.9 watts, 20 watts. So it'll be pretty simple here to see our power. Just subtract about 20 watts from whatever we get. Okay, so now we're booted up in HiveOS. I don't have the cable plugged in to detect this. I'm just doing a fan test right now. We can see we got this plugged into our Molex. It is down right now. We're sitting at about 19.9, 20 watts. It's still on low. So we're gonna spin this, and this is how we will adjust that fan if we need better cooling. So we're gonna crank that up. You can probably start to hear it ramp up now. I can definitely feel some air blowing here. And over here we are now at about 29 watts or so. So our fan is using like 9.4 watts. Okay, so we're all loaded up in HiveOS here. As you can see, the FPGA is not detected. So I've been going through some things here. I went to Serpent X's video. As you can see, he has a bunch of stuff. I will have his video actually linked in the description if you want to check it out. He does a bunch of stuff and he's a very smart guy here. But regardless, I'm doing things a little bit different. If we come into here, I LS through everything just to see exactly what was in every directory. And we got down all the way into our custom download of the latest Team Redminer, and here we can see just like how you'd normally started. At that point, I'm also going in, and this is the command I'm going to be running. I already adjusted everything based on having it in the extra config arguments here. I have my wallet address, and I'm going to be using the error auto mode here for the FPGA. So then what that is if you bring up here, you can see that it will start. You set the maximum clocks that you want it to hit, and it'll actually auto tune, but it'll take about 15 minutes to a half an hour to do so right here, 15 to 30 minutes here. And it's gonna find errors as it slowly ramps up the clock and then kind of tweak it out where it's nice and even to get a maximum type of hash rate. So that's kind of where I'm sitting at now. Let's hopefully this does work. So you can see I have everything in there, the sudo, which is like admin in Linux to start it. This is your start that program. And then all our parameters like you would run in like a bat file or something. So I'm gonna hit enter and see if anything happens. So it says Team Redminer version, only Stratum chooser and URLs are supported. Use options slash help for usage. So it looks like that didn't work. Okay, so I'm gonna run the exact same command, except I did add in Stratum plus TCP. So I guess it's not exactly the same, but it does look like it was saying I was missing it. So I'm gonna hit the enter button now, and it looks like Team Redminer version. And yeah, so it is gonna start doing something. So now I'm just gonna wait and see what happens. It should auto-tune. I got the fan cranked right up here because I don't know if I can view my temperatures or not. So it's cranked right up. So hopefully it is downloading the bit stream. Yes, so I believe all these bit streams that are currently available already in Team Redminer, so you don't have to look around for them. So if Team Redminer does support that bit stream, then you can begin mining it with an FPGA. So here we are trying Iron Fist. So it looks like things are loading up. Still no hash rate, but we're gonna give it some time and see what happens. So I am finding some shares. So it is looking like it's doing something. We're at about 10.43 gigahash right now, Iron Fist 9.3. So we are definitely mining at this point. Okay, so the power at the wall looks like everything is about 101 watts. So we do remove our 20 watts there. We're hanging out at about 81 watts and our looks like our temperatures are fairly cool at, where is it showing it here? It looks like about 38 degrees Celsius. So
We'll see what happens there. I could probably tweak the fans down a little bit for cooling, but it looks like we're around 49 gigahash. And looking over at the pool, we can see only one worker because I failed to put a worker name in for this when I did it. When I ran those parameters there, I didn't put my wallet or worker name after the wallet address. So everything is defaulted. Along with the E300, I didn't put a name in there. So it's all coming up as one worker, but we can see the bloop here coming in. So we can see averaging around 119 to 126 gigahash on the E300, and we shot upwards of 174, 160, and so on. So it is detected at the pool. We can see that it is working, but I failed at the worker names. Okay, so now we're going to backtrack a bit, and I'm going to show you, after doing some learning, watching videos, and figuring all this out, let's show you exactly how to get this up and running in Hive OS. So I'm going to go into my test bench here. I'm going to come up to the access. I'm going to do a Hive shell start. At this point, we got to wait for the Hive shell start to actually start. Well, you are waiting, which it is ready now. So I'm just going to click on it and go into it. That way it is there. We're going to begin making a flight sheet. So if you go to your flight sheet here, actually you're going to have to go all the way to your main one. So it has all your stuff here within the farm you're in. So if you have multiple farms, if you select a flight sheet, say you make it in the wrong farm, it won't show up where you are. So make sure you're in the proper farm where your rigs are. You're next going to go into flight sheets here, and then we're going to pick a coin. So in this case, we're going iron. We're going to pick iron fish, select wallet. I'm going to use node box here, pool, configure and miner, and we're going to use a custom miner. So we're going to go into here, custom miner, select custom, name it whatever you want, C1100 test. And now we're going to set up the miner config. So I can find it here somewhere, where it is. Here's Team Red Miner. You're going to find the Linux TGZ here. Right click it and save link as, or copy link address. I mean, don't save the link. We're trying to copy the link address for the download. So copy link address. We're going back into Hive OS, putting it into the install URL. Now you can see it'll bring up the version of the miner and everything. Now you just do your normal stuff. None of this really matters at this point. Pool URL, you can set all this up here. I'll actually run into Cryptex here and do it. So we're gonna go into here. I'm gonna need this right here. We're gonna right click that, copy it in. And I'm gonna use port 47. So bam, pool, colon, 1234. And that's pretty much it. So we're going to apply changes here, and then you're going to want to run this flight sheet. I already have it created, so I'm not going to do anything, but you're going to create this flight sheet so that it begins downloading the miner and everything. At that point, then we're going to navigate to it through Hive Shell, and it's just like you're normally running it through Linux, or through, if you're used to like DOS, obviously we're not using DOS here, but back in the day, command line stuff. So in the FPGA Ironfish guide, it tells you exactly what to use, especially if you want to use this auto-tuning, which I did do, this line right here. So I filled it all out. You can see my pool, my wallet and stuff is blank. I filled it up and I redid it and put it up top here and saved it. So here's my wallet address, this time with the actual worker name that I want to use, the Cryptex pool and everything. So here's my whole command. I saved it in this notepad. You can probably make your own notepad. I'm probably going to make one and have it all for each individual coin for these FPGAs that does have Bitstream support. So I'm just going to copy that. Now we're going to go to shell in a box, and we're going to navigate to where this installed. So we're going to do this from scratch here. We're going to ls so we can see all the folders. So here I want to go next, go into Hive, cd space Hive. And then every time I do a step, unless you know exactly where you're going, you can just do it all in one straight line. But I don't really know where I'm going yet, and I want to show you exactly what I'm looking for. So now we can see that we're in CD Hive. Here's all the directories that are in there. I want to go to the miners because we want to find the miner that downloaded. So we're going to go into here, miners, and now we're going to do LS again. And now we can see custom. So we're going to CD space custom. And then we should be able to see exactly where Team Red Miner is. So here it is. So I'm going to actually take this. I'm going to Control C, which is copy that. And I'm going to paste from browser, which I just copied. Paste that into there. Actually, we got to put CD first. I'm failing. I apologize, guys. So we're going to put that. Then we're going to go all the way back because we want to get into that Team Red Miner directory. Sorry for the white flashes. There. CD space, Team Red Miner, Linux, everything. So now we're in that directory where we have everything. So we're navigated to exactly where this is. At this point, this is when you're going to copy this entire line in. So I'm going to copy this batch file type of command line in here. We're going to paste from browser. I'm going to hit OK. And now it should run your miner. GMP, SS. Oh, I did it again. I didn't have the HTTP and stuff in front of here. So let's do a quick fix. Okay, so I updated it now to the Stratum Plus TCP. I don't know why I missed that again. That's twice. I missed it earlier and I missed it again the second time. I'm failing here. But anyway, you can see exactly what we have to do now. You know, sometimes it's good for these mistakes to happen. That way you can actually see some of these errors and stuff. And, you know, that helps you guys out with learning and whatnot. So now we're going to okay that, put all that in. We got our stratum and everything. Now we're going to hit enter and Team Redminer should start. Here we go. Team Redminer is now starting. So now I'm going to wait a bit and we should actually have a worker name in this case, unless they used a password as the worker name. Maybe I should have checked out the pool. That's one thing to kind of keep an eye on. So hopefully we do have a worker name this time. And the worker is still not showing up. Regardless, we know this thing is mining. The hash rate dropped and now it's picking back up. So we are working. This is working in HiveOS. That is how you get it done. Let's take a look at some current profitability of possible Ironfish right now. So 49 giga hash is about 49 cents right now at the current network conditions and price before power. We're using about 81 watts here. So that is 21 cents worth of power that we're using every day at 11 cents per kilowatt hour, or 27 cent profit. So there is some profitability, but I think these things are pretty expensive FPGAs. But the profit is there. If we come into hashrate.no here, they do have Ironfish actually listed as well as Caspa. It's the only two coins. So we're going to have to be testing this thing if I can find Bitstreams and everything and the other miners across multiple coins. But for them, they're saying Ironfish is making about 38 cents, 50 to 52 cents, only using 53 watts where we are using 80. But I do see they have a much lower hash rate. So obviously there's a lot of tweaking we can still do to look for an efficient number. I just want to get this up and running and see if we could get it done. And it definitely looks like we got the C1100 mining in HiveOS.
All right, guys, so here we have it. The C1100 is up and working. I do have power and everything going to the riser. I'm not 100% sure if you need to or not, but I do. And I think I did because I didn't see blue light wasn't there when that riser was not powered. So I do have that riser powered and plugged in down there. You can see everything I got set up here, that little cable that's coming in out of the front and going down to the USB right in down there. You can see it going down in there. So yeah, there we go. The C1100 is working 100%. Everything's looking good. Again, check out Serpent X. Without Serpent X video, I probably wouldn't have figured this out, or maybe I would have eventually, but it would have took a lot longer. Serpent X, thank you for helping out the community all the time. Guys, check out his channel, check out his videos. I'll see you all in the next one. Rabbit out.